It is so good to be with you again this Sunday morning, as it is each Sunday morning at this same time, and we hope that you have your Bibles and turn with us again as we go over here to the little book of Jonah. While you're turning over there to the book of Jonah, we find again, we'll keep repeating this, you'll have it down in your minds, you'll be waking up at night saying, in chapter 1, Jonah running away from God. Chapter 2, Jonah running to God. Chapter 3, Jonah running with God. Chapter 4, Jonah running ahead of God. So if you have your Bibles now, we're over here to the second chapter of the book of Jonah. And we have said, as we started last week, we're going to approach here Jonah swallowed by the whale here, and the verses here up to verse 6. We're going to apply this three ways. Last week, we viewed it from salvation, where Jonah is a type of Christ. For as Jonah was 3 days and three nights in the whale's belly, so shall the Son of Man be 3 days and three nights in the heart of the earth. Now we're looking at it from a doctrinal aspect. In Jonah chapter 2, notice here, if you will, let's begin with verse 1. Then Jonah prayed unto the Lord his God out of the fish's belly. Now, we are going to take this one step at a time here so that you get it. I would underline the word belly here, and we find out it comes from the Hebrew word meah, M-E-A-H, and it literally means abdomen. That's not too hard to understand. Then in verse 2, and I said, I cried by reason of my affliction unto the Lord, and he heard me out of the belly of hell, cried I, and thou heardest my voice. Now, we'd like for you to circle the word belly here in chapter 2, verse 2, because here we have another word, which is a Hebrew word, betan, B-E-T-A-N, and it does not mean, it's an entirely different word from belly here, of the fish's belly, but it means a hollow place. And the word hell here, again, is a mistranslation by the King James translators. That should have been transliterated, and it is the Hebrew word sheol, not hell. In fact, we are going to make this distinguishing mark here today and look at this for just a little bit. We do not have time for any kind of an exhaustive study, anything like that, but we do need to take a few minutes and point out the doctrinal differences here as far as the teaching of the Word of God on some of the various places. So we find out the word is sheol here. Other words, we find out that Jonah, when he was swallowed by the fish, the large fish, that he went down into the belly of the fish, and he was still alive, and he cried out unto the Lord. And then he died. And then he separated from the body. He went down into a hollow place, which is in Sheol, not hell now. In fact, we'll say this because we'll not have time to go into great detail on it. But actually in hell, which is translated in the New Testament from Gehenna or Gehenna, and it is actually only spoken of 12 times. We find out that beginning with Matthew chapter 5, that the everlasting fire, Gehenna, is spoken of 11 times by the Lord Jesus himself and appears only one other time in the whole New Testament, and that is found in James chapter 3, verse 6. So out of the 12 times where we find hell translated properly now from Gehenna, it comes 11 times by Christ himself, one time in the book of James, chapter 3, verse 6. But here's a different word and a different place, and the word is Sheol. Now, up until Christ died, there were no Old Testament saints ever went to heaven. Everyone, whether they were saved or lost, went into a place called Sheol. Now, turn with me over here, if you will, to the New Testament, because we can only give the sketch of this because of our time on the air. We do not have time to go into a detailed study of it, but I think we can give enough here to separate it. In fact, the book that we have written, A Biblical Examination of Hell, we have covered all of this in there with the diagrams and things like that. But this will be enough this morning to at least show the distinguishing difference between the various places. Now, over here in Luke chapter 16, and begin here with verse 19, there was a certain rich man which was clothed with purple and fine linen, and he fared sumptuously every day. There was a certain beggar named Lazarus, which was laid at his gate full of sores, and desiring to be fed with the crumbs which fell from the rich man's table. Moreover, the dogs came and licked his sores. Now notice in verse 22, and it came to pass the beggar died, and was carried by the angels unto Abraham's bosom, and the rich man also died and was buried. Now we have some teaching, especially the Jehovah's Witnesses, that when you die, your soul and spirit stays with the body. And they say that you go into the grave and you're in a state of annihilation. But then we say this, if that's the true case and your soul and spirit never separate from your body, where in the world are the angels carrying you then? Where, what reason are they to get involved? In fact, the Bible does tell us over in James chapter 2, verse 26, that the body without the spirit is dead. But here we have two men, one was saved and one was lost, and they were taken into Sheol. Now notice in verse 23, and in hell he lift up his eyes, and here the King James translators erred again. Now there are not that many errors. We're not trying to discredit the Word of God here, but we're showing that the translators here did not correctly translate this word here, which is Hades, which is exactly the same place as Sheol in the Old Testament. Here the word hell is mistranslated, and the Revised Standard has it correctly, and they have the correct word there of Hades. Now, up until Christ was crucified and ascended back to heaven, we find that the saved and the lost both went into the center of the earth, and that's where it is. Remember when Christ died, used here as an example of Jonah in Matthew 12:40. For as Jonah was 3 days and three nights in the whale's belly, so shall the Son of Man be 3 days and three nights in the heart of the earth, or the center of the earth. Now, we find out here in verse 24, he cried and said, Father Abraham, have mercy on me, and dip my finger, the tip of his finger in water, and cool my tongue, for I'm tormented in this flame. Now, we find out that everyone went there who was lost. There was a great gulf that separated the two places. Now, notice in verse 25, Abraham said, Son, remember thou in thy lifetime receiveth the good things, likewise Lazarus evil. Now he is comforted, and thou art tormented. Now, in verse 26, the two compartments, we find out here, the Lazarus was comforted. He was in what was called paradise, or Abraham's bosom. And we find the lost man was in torment. But between the two places in the center of the earth, we find out that there was a tremendous gulf so that no one could pass from one side unto the other. And notice here, if you will, in verse 26, and besides all this, between us and you, there is a great gulf fixed so that they which would pass from hence to you cannot, neither can they pass to us that would from thence. Now, we find out about this place, and let me say this, this is not Gehenna or Gehenna, the everlasting lake of fire. The literal hell or the everlasting hell, there is no one in that particular place today. No one in Gehenna. But we are going to find out here what in the world happened then. When the Lord Jesus Christ came, the saved that were in the paradise side over there with Lazarus, we find out when Christ died, he went into that paradise side. Now, if you have your Bibles, just jot this down or look at it. In Luke chapter 23, verse 43, we find out, speaking to the thief on the cross there, that he had said, Lord, remember me when thou comest into thy kingdom. And the Lord said to him, today shalt thou be with me in paradise. Now, he went to paradise. Now, turn with me back to the Old Testament, to Psalms, if you will. And let's go back here to Psalms chapter 16, and let's notice here in verse 10. Psalm 16:10, here's the prophecy of the Lord Jesus, and we read back here, for thou wilt not leave my soul in hell. Now, if you'll notice here, the word hell is mistranslated again, but the Revised Standard has it correctly. And the word is Sheol here, neither wilt thou suffer thine Holy One to see corruption. So we found out that as Jonah was 3 days and three nights in the whale's belly, so shall the Son of Man be 3 days and three nights in the heart of the earth. And here we find out here that the Lord said, you'll not leave my soul in, not hell now, that's a mistranslation, in Sheol, you'll not leave it there, neither wilt thou suffer thy Holy One to see corruption, that is the body. Now corruption or putrefaction begin to set in on the fourth day, and we find out that when Christ died and when he was crucified, that his soul went into the paradise side of Sheol, and his body went to be enwrapped there, and to be wrapped with spices and so forth, and laid in the tomb 3 days. But then his soul came out of paradise, united with his resurrected body, and there he walked on the earth then another 40 days. Now, if you go on over here to the book of Acts, in chapter 2, verse 27, you'll find out that the writer, Luke, here quotes the verse here in Psalms chapter 16, verse 10. And when he does this in verse 27, because thou wilt not leave my soul in hell, neither wilt thou suffer thine holy one to see corruption, the word hell here is the Greek word Hades. So the Old Testament word is Sheol, the New Testament word is Hades, and both are referring to the same place. Now, to confirm the fact that this is located in the center of the earth, let us go back here, if you will. There are many places. We're just taking a brief sketch here in the limited time that we have. Now, notice here back in the book of Numbers, if you will, back here, and let's go here to the 16th chapter, if you will. Numbers chapter 16, and let's notice here in verse 30. I'm sure that you'll recall the story back here when Dathan and Abiram, who were the sons of Eliab, and they contended against Moses and Aaron and challenged their authority that God had given them in leading the nation of Israel. Now let's pick it up here in verse 30. But if the Lord make a new thing, and the earth open her mouth and swallow them up with all that appertain unto them, and they go down quick into the pit. Now, I'd circle the word pit here because it is the translation from the Hebrew word Sheol that we have been speaking about. And notice in verse 32, and the earth opened her mouth and swallowed them up in their houses, and all the men that appertaineth unto Korah and all their goods, they and all that appertained to them went down alive into the pit, and the earth closed upon them. And the word pit here is the same word as not leave my soul in hell, Sheol, same one. So the earth opened her mouth, whether it was by a volcano, whether it was by an earthquake, we do not know, but we do know this, that all of them that opposed Moses there went down right then into the torment side there into the center of the earth called the pit. Now, you say, I thought you said, Pastor Younce, there was no one in the everlasting lake of fire. There is not today. They will not be in there until the end of the tribulation, where we find out the beast and the false prophet and are going to be cast in there. And then we're going to find out at the end of the 1,000-year millennial reign, we're going to find out that Satan, along with the beast and the false prophet, is cast into the lake of fire. Now, we do not have time to turn to all these, so we'll try to give these just as possibly as fast as we can. You'll find in Matthew chapter 25, verse 41, where the Lord said, for the hell was created for the devil and his angels. Now, the word hell there is not Sheol, it is not Hades, but it is Gehenna or Gehenna, and it is the everlasting lake of fire. That is the final abode of the wicked. Now, hold your place and go on back, or I should say, turn with me back to Revelation chapter 20 now, if you will. Revelation chapter 20, and we're going to find that Christ is going to empty all those in Hades, and they're going to have a resurrection and be brought up to stand at the great white throne judgment, and then after they're judged according to their works for the degrees of punishment in the everlasting lake of fire. Now let's notice here, if you will, in verse 13. Now this is the resurrection here now of the lost. This is bringing them up out of Hades. And the sea gave up the dead which were in it, and death and hell. Now, if you have a Schofield Bible or a Thompson Chain reference, you'll find the word hell here is not Gehenna. It is not the everlasting lake of fire, but it is Hades, the place that we are talking about, the same place that Jonah went to, only he went to the paradise side, separated by a great gulf, and the rich man went to torment. And this is the same place these lost people are here and where they go today. Every lost person today goes to the center of the earth in the torment side of Hades. Now notice what it said. And death and Hades delivered up the dead which were in them, and they were judged every man according to their works. And now the works is not to determine their position. When they died rejecting Christ, they either went... See, when they rejected Christ, they were put into torment here. When the saved person died and accepted Christ prior to his death, he went to the paradise side. Now notice here in verse 14, and death and hell. Here we have a mistranslation again on this. King James just translated all the places of torment, just translated them on a standard word of hell. but that is not the way it is in the Greek text. So we find out here death and hell, that is Hades, were cast into the lake of fire, and this is the second death. And whosoever was not found written in the book of life was cast into the lake of fire. So then we find here what happened to those we find, or you may say, concerning here those that are saved. Well, in Ephesians 4, the Lord tells us here, said, who is he that descended into the lower parts of the earth, but he ascended up on high, and he led captivity captive. And when he ascended up on high, he emptied the paradise side of Sheol. And now we are told in 2 Corinthians that I would rather be absent from the body and present with the Lord. We're not absent from the body and absent from the Lord into Sheol or the paradise side. We're absent now from the body and present with the Lord. He had taken all those that were saved, taken them up to glory with him. They're up there now. Every saved person in the Old Testament time is now up in glory. And the Lord said that he had to take his own blood and anoint the mercy seat up there in heaven. When he did, then he made it, therefore purified all things himself as the tabernacle and the high priest purified things here in the tabernacle and the temple. We find that Christ did that with his own blood laying upon the altar of the temple in heaven. Now, therefore, he had went to prepare a place for us, that where I am, there ye may be also. And that's what the Lord Jesus did. So we find out he went to the cross. He did die. When he died, his body was in the grave 3 days, just as Jonah was in the whale's body 3 days and three nights. But out of Sheol, we find out, Betan, the belly or the hollow place of Sheol, he cried out unto the Lord. So Jonah cried out not only on the whale's belly before he died, but he also cried out after he had died. Jonah died. He did not pull up. Now, I used to think, and I've heard this so many times, you know, we're trying to find a fish where a man can be alive in there 3 days and three nights. And I could just picture old Jonah, you know, he'd pull up his little old stool there and sit in that whale's belly, or maybe get up and walk around, look at a few ribs, and go back and sit down again. And I thought, boy, what a stench. That guy, how in the world can he stand to smell all those gastric juices in that big whale's body? And how in the world can he breathe? Can he get enough air in there and so forth? And I used to have a lot of things I worried about. You know, when I was a young Christian, and even thought about that, I'd heard that in Sunday school before I was saved. But the fact is, Jonah died. He did not sit down there, and he was not alive in the whale's belly for 3 days and three nights. We find out that he died, and he cried out unto the Lord when he first went into the whale's belly. Then in verse 2, we have a different word, a different Hebrew word for belly. That is Betan, means a hollow place, an entirely different word. The Holy Spirit chose explicitly and precisely what Hebrew words he wanted used. And then out of hell, which is Sheol, we find that Jonah cried again after he had died. Then we're going to find out that he had a resurrection and that the Lord had the fish cough him up and spit him back out, typifying the resurrection of the Lord Jesus Christ. And we find out that Christ died. His death was a necessity. And without his death and without his blood, there is no remission of sins. For those now who have received the Lord Jesus Christ, again we repeat, when we come or to the point of death, and when we die here upon the earth prior to the rapture here, if we would happen to go on through the portals of death before the rapture, we are absent from the body and present with the Lord. Now, I'd like for you to look one more place here before we close this morning. If you'll turn with me over to Revelation chapter 20, I'd like for you to notice now, if you will, here in verse 10. Now, if you've rejected the Lord Jesus Christ, you've never received him as your Savior, we find out that you're going to be cast into the lake of fire here, as we have found previously here, after you're brought up to the great white throne judgment. You now would go into Hades in the torment side in the center of the earth. You'll be there until the end of the thousand-year reign of Christ, here upon at least 1,000 years plus. And then you'll be brought up out of there and stand before the King of Kings and the Lord of Lords. And then we find here also that you're going to be accompanied by, notice here in verse 10, and the devil that deceiveth them, that's you. If you've rejected the Lord Jesus, you have been deceived. He is a liar and the father of all lies, and you are his son. You are a son of Satan. Can you imagine that? Every lost person. I know that's pretty strong, but you know, maybe it's strong enough to have you realize and lift up your eyebrows and see where you're headed. There is nothing but total damnation. There's nothing but the lake of fire which burns with brimstone and the vengeance of God's wrath upon you, because you would not accept God's wrath upon his son by faith in Christ. You chose to absorb God's wrath yourself. And the Bible says here in verse 10, the devil that deceiveth them was cast into the lake of fire and brimstone, where the beast and the false prophet are, and they shall be tormented day and night forever and ever. And that's exactly where you're going to be if you've rejected the Lord Jesus Christ. Oh, I hope that you'll put your faith in him. Receive him. God never wanted to do anything to hurt you. You see, in order, God does not want to send you to hell. But you choose to go there because you have a choice. You do not have to go to hell and pay for your sin. But God said, I'll give you the choice. I'm not going to make you a robot. I'm going to give you a free choice. I want you to choose. This is one responsibility and decision that you'll live by or you'll die by. We hope you'll turn to the Lord Jesus. God said, I love the world so much, I gave my only begotten Son, that whosoever believeth in him should not perish, but have everlasting life. And he said, I didn't come into the world to condemn the world, but that the world through him might be saved. And that's God's will for you, that you'll trust the Lord Jesus and have everlasting life, and you'll be delivered from the wrath of God in this lake of fire that is yet to come. God said, I've created it for the devil and his angels. And he says also in Matthew 25:41, depart from me, ye cursed, into the everlasting fire, prepared for the devil and his angels. You'll be there with Satan himself. And what a devastating thought that is. There'll be weeping, gnashing of teeth. You'll be there, but you'll only be there not because God wanted you there, but because you chose to go there. You disbelieved the Lord. You refused his son. And you have chosen your own destiny, the condemnation and the wrath of Almighty God. I don't know who you are that are listening, but if you've rejected Christ, you'll be the sorriest person that has ever been born on the face of the earth, friend. I hope you'll turn and flee the wrath of God. Turn to the Lord Jesus Christ. He loved you. He wants to save you. And if you'll believe on him right now, as he died to pay for your sins, God says you're passed from death unto life. You'll never perish. Believest thou this? Well, I see our time's gone. We've enjoyed being with you again this Sunday morning. We hope you'll take a minute and write us. Let us know that you're listening. Until next week, may the truth of God's Word keep marching on.
Trust Christ, he takes my sin and he says, Max, your sin's all paid for. You know, I bought it, I paid for it, and now I'll give you my righteousness. Any man be in Christ, he is a new creation. All things passed away, all things become new, and therefore he has made him, Christ, to be sin for me, that I might be found and made the righteousness of God in him. So he gives me his righteousness. I say, man alive, I haven't had that since I've been born. I may have had it when I was a baby. Mom hugged me and said, oh, he's a righteous, beautiful little old boy. You know there. But it faded fast as I grew. But now I am an adult, and I'm as righteous because I have the righteousness of Jesus Christ. Mm-hmm. And he has my sin that he took 2,000 years ago and completely paid for, and I'm now his child. I'm looking forward to being with him, and he's looking forward to having me up there. How in the world could I do less than give him my best and live for him completely? Isn't it wonderful?